President Marcos says former President Rodrigo Duterte is accountable for the supposed gentleman's agreement he made with China. Marcos challenges Duterte to reveal details of the agreement, including any documents related to the deal.
Hindi ko nga maintindihan. Very experienced lawyer si President Duterte. Bakit walang nakasulat na kahit isang papel? Bakit walang video? Bakit di nila sinabi sa amin nung kami pumasok? Na sabihin, meron kaming usapan. I disagree with idea that you enter into a secret agreement. You know, you have any agreement with another sovereign state should really be known by the people. That way, you're accountable. If it's a bad decision, you're accountable. We need to know, what did you agree to? What did you compromise? Ano yung pinamigay ninyo?
Duterte earlier admitted he agreed to maintain the status quo in the West Philippine Sea in a bid to avoid conflict with China, but he denied conceding anything to the Chinese. Marcos also shrugged off Duterte's recent verbal attacks against him. Duterte called Marcos a weak leader and a crybaby for revitalizing the country's ties with the U.S. The chief executive says Duterte's cheap shots have no place in important discussions.
To be a crybaby, you have to cry. Did you see me cry? I don't pay any attention to that. I really don't. That means absolutely nothing to me. And, you know, again, the former president is a highly experienced lawyer. He should know that ad hominem attacks like that are really have no place in this kind of very important and very precarious discussions. Na sasabihin, pangit ka eh. Sige, di pangit ako, so what?
A maritime law expert calls out former President Rodrigo Duterte for agreeing with China to keep the status quo on the BRP Sierra Madre, the country's lone outpost in the West Philippine Sea. Dr. Jeffrey Ordaniel, Director for Maritime Security, Pacific Forum International, says this agreement is a clear violation of the Philippine Constitution and international law. Ordaniel explains Ayungin Shoal, where the grounded warship is located, is well within the country's exclusive economic zone. This means, according to Ordaniel, the Philippines has the exclusive rights to exploit and explore its resources and the right to build artificial structures in the area.
So, kung mag-decide man ang Pilipinas na we reinforce that vessel and maybe build a structure on top of it, that's within our rights under international law.
On Thursday, former President Duterte admitted that the deal involved not bringing construction materials for the repair and upkeep of the BRP Sierra Madre, which is in dire need of repairs. Some analysts say without intervention, the Second World War era will succumb to the elements in time. Meantime, Ordaniel also commends the actions made by President Marcos to support a rules-based international order in the West Philippine Sea. A legal expert believes former President Duterte could be charged with violating the anti-graft law over his supposed secret deal with China involving Sierra Madre in Ayungin Shoal. Speaking to Teleradio Serbisyo, former Supreme Court Associate Justice Antonio Carpio said the Philippines was put at a disadvantage when Duterte accepted a status quo agreement with Chinese President Xi Jinping. Carpio added the deal violates the country's constitution. The former magistrate also slammed the Duterte administration for keeping the public in the dark over their agreement with China.
He agreed not to bring construction materials, and we have the exclusive right to put up a structure. Ang ginawa niya, krinipol niya yung ating right. Ni-reduce niya yung right natin. Ang sabi ni Duterte, that is just personal agreement. Eh, kahit na siya, hindi niya mapaklaro sa China kung anong klaseng agreement yon. Gusto niya, personal lang, gentleman's agreement. Pero ang China, sabi nila, that is a state-to-state agreement. Eh, ano klaseng president na yun? Hindi niya alam anong ginagawa niya. any undue advantage given by Duterte to China is a violation of the anti-graft law.
Mm-hmm.
So pwede yung gagamitin na yun. At saka yung prescription period nito is 20 years. So in the next 20 years, from 2022, June 30, 2022, he can be charged and prosecuted for this, no?
On Thursday, former President Duterte said he conceded nothing to China during his administration, but he admitted that he agreed to maintain the status quo in the West Philippine Sea.
Aside from the fact of having a handshake with President Xi Jinping, the only thing I remember was that status quo. That's the word, na walang galawan. No movement, no armed patrols there, as is where is, para walang magkagulo. Hindi tayo magkagulo. Yun ang naalaala ko.
A Senate probe on the alleged deal has been sought, with some critics of the former president calling the agreement treasonous and unconstitutional. President Marcos meets with Google executives in Washington to boost digital transformation efforts in the Philippines. Google Global Vice President Karen Bhatia says they discussed possible additional infrastructure investments by the tech giant to further improve internet connectivity in the Philippines.
Some of the specific areas we talked about included some of the infrastructure investments that we have already made in the Philippines, including on subsea cables that are connecting the Philippines to the rest of the world, enabling ongoing growth of the Philippines internet industry, YouTube creators. So a lot of good discussion there about some of the things that we are been doing and things that we would like to consider continuing to do.
The Philippine Transportation Department says nearly 80% of public transport operators have complied with the consolidation requirement under the PUV Modernization Program. DOTR Undersecretary Andy Ortega says the high number of compliance shows strong support for the program as the April 30 deadline nears. President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. has ruled out another extension for consolidation, despite strong opposition from some transport groups. Ortega says it's time the country moves forward on the program to give commuters a better riding experience.
So it's a clear sign, which noon pa naman, talagang clear sign, that the majority in the transportation sector ay talagang agree, sasama dito sa ating pagbabago po. Not only sa mga sasakyan, but pagbabago po ng sistema. So 100% po, go po yung ating programa. We respect the decision, yung mga ayaw, talagang ayaw nilang sumama. Respeto po natin yung kanilang decision. But sa dulo po, the big majority, we will have to move forward, them, us in the government, because yung ating po mga mananakay, matagal na po naghihintay talagang magbago, ma-upgrade yung sistema ng ating transportation dito sa Pilipinas po.
The Philippine Transportation Department assures commuters the government is prepared for next week's jeepney strike. The agency said Saturday state-owned vehicles will be on standby to cater to passengers affected by the two-day protest of public utility drivers.
They've been doing this a few times last year, no? So, and they're doing it again. So the government po will be prepared sa kanilang magiging protest rally or strike po sa April 15 and 16. Ang importante po dito is that yung meron silang usong gawin, they have the right to do it as long as it's within the bounds of the law.
Bad news for motorists, a fourth straight oil price hike looms next week. Diesel prices may see the biggest jump of as much as 1 peso, while gasoline prices may increase by up to 40 centavos per liter. Kerosene also seeing a 90 centavo price jump. The DOE still attributes the higher pump prices to the ongoing conflict in the Middle East. Metro Manila authorities defer to next month the implementation of a new work schedule in local government offices in the capital region. Vivian Gulia reports.
Cholo, who works at the Quezon City government's engineering office, is looking forward to the implementation of the 7 a.m. to 4 p.m. work schedule. He says he would rather be up a little earlier than still be on his commute home at dark.
Maaga ka talaga nagigising kami estudyante, gano'n. Tulad ko. Ang hirap umuwi ng alas 5 eh. Traffic na, tsaka gagabihin ka pa.
Cholo will have to wait nearly 3 weeks more as the Metro Manila Council deferred the implementation of the new work schedule to May 2nd from the initial effectivity date of April 15th.
Upang mabigyan ng sapat na panahon ang ating publiko na malaman na meron ng ganitong pagbabago po sa oras.
The MMC previously approved a resolution modifying the current 8 a.m. to 5 p.m. work hours in Metro Manila LGU offices to help ease traffic congestion during rush hours. The Metropolitan Manila Development Authority will also implement the 7 a.m. to 4 p.m. work schedule beginning May 2nd, except for frontline services where workers observe flexible work hours. MMDA Acting Chairman Attorney Romando Artis says more than half of national government agencies are open to adopting the same work schedule for their offices in Metro Manila.
Nag-survey din po ang Malacanang. I think mga 70% ng mga departments ay nag-agree. Yung iba lang po ay may reservations nga regarding yan. Paano yung ganitong trabaho nila, like yung mga frontline services, halos lahat nag-agree na maghahanap ng akmang adjustment sa kanilang mga ehensya.
The MMDA chairman told the media that in a cabinet meeting, among other traffic congestion mitigation proposals tackled include the imposition of fees for certain roads during rush hours and allowing high occupancy vehicles to pass through the EDSA busway. Both proposals, however, were not accepted. The MMDA meanwhile reminded e-bike and e-trike users that such units are banned on Metro Manila's major thoroughfares beginning April 15th.
Doon po sa ating mga kababayan na gumagamit ng e-bikes, e-trikes at mga kuliglings, tricycles, bawal na po kayo sa mga pangunahing lansangan dito sa Metro Manila by April 15. Mag-start na po tayo manghuli. Hindi na po natin iyan i-extend. Ang penalty po ay 2,500. Pero kung kayo po ay walang lisensya or walang rehistro yung e-bikes or e-trikes, yan po ay masasubject sa pag-impound.
Vivian Gulia, ABS-CBN News.